I'm on hood clips. Pass me some chip. Yeah. Pass me some salsa too, so I can dip. Maybach whip. That's what I'm rolling. Diamonds in my mouth and the chain is golden. Yeah. It's frozen.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I like to stand out. I've always been a standout
person.
See, when
you stand out.
I've always been a person to challenge reality, challenge information.
If it's a rule, break that.
It ain't even necessarily break the rule. It's the thin line between breaking a rule and testing a rule to see did it actually have purpose being there in the first place. I went through all the hard shit the hard way, like a man, from a boy to a man. I've always dealt with life as a man. I've always had to think and move and act like a man. That's why, at the same time, I do all the childish shit and I do all the fun and having fun and not giving a fuck, because my childhood was raw for me from the time I had a childhood. So at the end of the day, I'ma make my whole life fun. Who that boy in? Got so many millions and I barely be recording.
Standing in the section with my fishes, we by rust. Yo, what's up, man? We in the building right now, hanging out. Yep, and it's a beautiful day.
It is.
You know why it's a beautiful day, Mr. Walker?
Tell me why.
Because Houston is in the building right now, man.
Absolutely. I thought you was going to say it a little sooner.
Oh, wait.
Sauce Walker's in the building.
You know,
what the dripster.
What's your favorite ad-lib? I mean, I like Uwe, personally. You know, I know you got a lot of them motherfuckers you can pull out at any given time.
I probably would say, Sue! That one.
Damn.
The Sue's.
Where you coming up with this? It seems like you just be chilling and then out of nowhere, you like, oh, new ad-lib, I'm using that.
I don't know, man. I just always been a fan of art and sound and music and superheroes and Super Saiyans and anime characters, and they all have signature sounds and signature gestures that they do that's, you know, loved by everybody. You know, you have the Street Fighter. Hadouken!
I love that game, by the way. That was that game.
You have the Mortal Kombat, Liu Kang. What the fuck? Hear me? You got Goku, Kamehameha, Sauce Walker. Oh wait,
what was that one movie with Johnny? The Black Karate Kid, the Black Karate movie. It was, you know what I'm talking
Bruce
about.
Leroy?
Dragon. It was like, it was. What's his name? I think his name was Leroy in the movie.
Nah, Hidden Dragon, something Dragon Street.
You know what I'm talking
about? But the one with Bruce Leroy and Show Enough.
Come on,
Show Enough.
Yeah, that used to be my one right there.
Yeah. A lot of people say I like Show Enough. I think I'm gonna get a Show Enough tattoo one day. A lot of people say we act like. A little bit.
For real?
Yeah.
I can see it. First of all, I seen you earlier doing your thing. How many tattoos do you really have? Because you're tatted. I got one tattoo, so.
You only got one tattoo?
I got one tattoo. You making me feel like a little bitch. I need to go get some more or something. This is crazy.
I'm pretty covered, man. I would say I probably got like 85%
tattoos.
Nah, I ain't got no 85 tattoos. I got more than that.
You got
I probably got 80% of my body is tatted. Like, I only got one, my left leg is tatted all the way to the middle of my thigh. Like, fully sleeved from the bottom of my, ankle to the middle of my thigh. And I got both of my arms completely done to my fingertips. The full left side and the full right side of my chest to my torso, and then my whole back is the same way. I got the full left side of my body. In the full right side of my body, I just don't. Only place I don't really have full tattoos is in the middle, because I just like kind of drew it out like that.
Is it one that's like, this one my favorite of all time? Like, out of all your tattoos, do you love one more than another?
I think it's two tattoos that's like the most important to me that got like significant.
Yeah.
One is the tattoo of my brother that passed away, Mario. My brother been. I got my brother's face tatted on me.
Oh, that's hard.
So no matter. And then it's really the saying that's underneath it, plus his picture. The saying says, Steel Marvin. And, like, that was the name of our group growing up. It was like Mob Stars. It was like a mob of stars. You know, that was the name of our childhood clique or whatever. And so,
but they had nothing like, to do with the Chibata Boys. They had nothing to do with Chibata Boys.
That was right before the that's what birthed the Chibata Boys. They remember, I always tell the story that that was the group before the Chibata Boys. Mash Mo, Mob Stars. That was a group. Mash Mo, Mob Stars. So, but you know, to mob, like you have a mob of people and they mob down the street or, you know. Sure. So me saying still Marvin, it's like he's still Marvin with me. He's still with me.
Oh, that's real.
No matter what I do, you know what I'm saying? When I was young and I was like obnoxious, I'd be like, hey, bro, we finna go fuck this bitch, bitch. I'm finna show you this girl booty. You finna see it. Get some pussy, boy. I'm finna show you. Like, my brother with me through everything I'm going through or whatever, fights or whatever. It's like, I took him with me. And the other tattoo that is my favorite is probably probably be the top from the Mortal Kombat crest. The Mortal Kombat Dragon Chris on my chest, or a spawn tattoo that I have on my leg.
Damn.
Yeah, it's out of those two.
One of those two. Well, I mean, everybody sees Sauce Walka now. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Between the shows, between social media. Between the fights.
Yeah, I done went viral on Hood Clips a few times now, too.
A few times at this point. You know what I'm saying? It's only right that you on What's Hood. You know, I want people to kind of get to know who Sauce Walka is. You know what I mean? If we could do that for a quick second.
Mm-hmm.
Growing up, you know what I'm saying? We got a chance to talk with Papa Sauce for a quick second. He actually out here hanging, too.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, what was Sauce Walka like as a child? Like, have you always had this energy? I know you, everyone, like, your energy crazy.
Like Dennis the Menace. This is how I was. I always been bad. I always been loud. I always been mischievous, aggressive.
Your ass was fighting so.
Yeah, I've been fighting my whole life. I always fought. I always started fights. I did karate. I did boxing, nunchucks, katanas, shurikens. Like, I used to practice how to use weapons when I was a kid. Like,
you look pretty good with them damn nunchucks on Instagram.
Okay,
I said,
you can
hold
see
on,
it.
Now, it kind of look like he been practicing this.
Yeah, nah. I used to do that shit. I really am skilled in the form of martial arts as far as, like, with weapons, though. Like, certain weapons.
Like,
I
you
know
got
how
a belt, like,
them.
Black belt, white belt, like.
I got a red belt. I went to, red. Stop. I was young. I got to where I could do full splits and, you know what I'm saying? Just certain shit from karate. But one of my original, what's crazy is one of my karate instructors growing up was Zachary, the Black Power Ranger.
No, for real?
I swear to God, it's crazy as hell. One of the karate schools I used to go to as a kid, Zach, it was like the one little period of time that my mom was.
And that boy took off with that shit.
Yeah. It was crazy. To be honest, I think it was a little bit after he was already a Power Ranger, though. He was already a Power Ranger, then he, like, was off. They switched it from being a Black Ranger to an Asian Black Ranger and some other stuff. He ended up coming back on the show later on. But it was during the time that he was off the show, and he was, like, an actual karate instructor.
Wow.
And I ended up being in his class for, like, 3 weeks.
You know what I love about you, bro? Every bit of your personality shows
How I am.
It's like you think he just gonna be like this nigga, but then you see the Karate Kid in him.
Yeah.
And then you see a transition, and you know what I'm saying? You bringing out all these different emotions. It's like every piece of you, like, is literally still living in you. Some people are buried that Karate Kid in them. You see what I'm saying? And be like, I ain't on that kind
of
shit no more.
Yeah, because, I mean, you know, it's a mixture of things. People can blame it on maturity, but in actuality, it's just like people just not confident with who they are as a person. And a lot of people live off of the standards and the opinions of others. And a lot of the things that they genuinely did enjoy or like doing, they may have been afraid to show other people that that's what they genuinely like doing because they didn't receive the response or the same level of attention is when they partake of something that everybody likes to do or that they see everybody else doing.
Yeah.
So they feel more comfortable fitting in than standing out. I like to stand out. I've always been a standout person.
But see, when
you
stand out, people think you weird, Sauce. People will say, like, but that boy's some other shit.
And,
that boy
and
weird.
People also say that most geniuses are crazy. And most part, smart people who are smart are actually stupid. So which one you rather be? You rather be a genius that's considered crazy, which you're actually a genius in some skill, some art form, some level of knowledge, some level of success. You're a genius. People think Donald Trump is crazy, but he's a genius. People think Elon Musk is crazy. He's a genius. And I could keep going on a long list of line of people. Then you got certain people that may have been considered to be smart, But one dumb decision or two dumb decisions can ruin everything that they've created or everything that they own. But a genius can make a million mistakes, but because they are at such level of genius, it's not that they're failure-proof, but it's when a genius has a certain level of being a phenom or being exceptionally smart, skilled, or talented and able to create and maneuver through thought with the skill, because you can be smart and be good at something which is a talent, mm-hmm. but you don't necessarily have the skill. Mm. You see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. When you have talent and skill together, you're the complete package. You the complete package, because you can do everything that the person that had to work very, very hard to get to the same level. So he knows, he's like the Tim Duncan. He knows all the playbooks, all the correct positions on the court to be at, the exact positioning on defense and passing. And I know what each player on the field does best and not as good. I know how each person plays their position. But physically, I don't jump 50 centimeters off the ground, and I don't necessarily run as fast as the point guard, right. even though I'm a power forward / center. I don't have the physical capacity as LeBron James to beat our point guard in the sprint. So a person that comes to the NBA or comes to a sport that has all of the IQ of a Tim Duncan, but I still have the physical attributes of a LeBron James, then you can get, I don't know, you could get a Greek freak if he had a Greek freak of a type of a player, if he had a little bit more of a shot and a little bit more fundamentals leaning towards the playing the center post position the way that Tim Duncan does, but still being able to push the ball up the court like a point guard the way Greek Freak does that. He can push the ball up the court.
And he pull up too.
Yeah, and he will pull up. And he will pull up. That's why I said about LeBron James, because LeBron James is like a 60-50% make the shot type as far as shooting from outside the perimeter or shooting three or whatever. And Greek Freak is like around the area but a little bit less. But if he had just a little bit more shot, a little bit more skill, that's like the hybrid player. Mm-hmm. Like you're starting to see a lot of more hybrid players coming to the league and having more success, like Joker. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
A center that pass and shoot and run the ball up the court and does all these other different things that you don't necessarily
think his person, his size will do.
Exactly. So going back to my original point, is to me, it's better to be a person that's a genius than just be considered smart, you know what I'm saying, or be considered a hard worker. Or could be, but you have to have, you can't deny the hard work regardless, but just somebody who just knows how to fall in place and go with the system, go with the flow of things. Mm. I'm just not that type of a person. I've never been that type of person. I've always been a person to challenge reality, challenge information.
If it's a rule, break that motherfucker.
It ain't even necessarily break the rule. It's the thin line between breaking a rule and testing a rule to see did it actually have purpose being there in the first place. That's the difference.
That's a fact. Because it's only impossible till somebody do it.
Absolutely. And half of the knowledge and information that we have inside of our glass, of our cup, you know, your soul, your spirit, your consciousness, your way of thinking is an empty glass. The information and your way of being and your moral system and all that shit, your diet and what you eat and what you watch and what you do and don't do, the way you wash your clothes, that's all poured inside of your glass. So at the end of the day, I just always been a person to not be afraid to challenge what has been poured inside of my thinking pattern. So to pour some of that water out and replace it with new information or new perspective, to know what was told to me is truth, is actually truth or not.
You know, it's crazy you said that, bro, because I ain't going to lie to you, bro. It be stuff I be thinking about, like, like, you know what I'm saying? Because at first I ain't never really think, like, you know, you black, so you automatically supposed to be a Democrat.
Yeah, who said that? Who told you that?
And then you start growing up and making your money, and it's like,
why would I want to be that?
I want to keep my money. Maybe I'm more Republican than I think. Then you know I what think I'm saying? Right. Or like, why are you a Christian? You know what I'm saying? It's like, exactly. Because that's what my grandma and my everybody, that's what I grew up knowing. But then when you get older, it's like, well, what's this? What's that? How did I learn it?
I might be feeling Muslim today.
You know what I'm saying?
I might be feeling something else. I might be feeling, you know, maybe I want to challenge science and see what they feel is true.
Because they grew up this way and they believe like, stomp 10 toes down on shit.
Who said water is water? Why can't water be sky? Why can't sky be water? Who knows? Like, what the thing that I feel like that harms our people in general, before I speak on just people as a whole, but we talking about our people, is that we're not willing to compare and contrast and go research certain, what is the word?
Do the homework.
Just really for everyday, just common sense and common knowledge, this is necessarily, it's not necessarily common. Mm. See what I'm saying? It's only common if you are around this type of information to where you can reciprocate it and it's given to you, or it's only common if you have the common sense and understanding that was also given to you to go search for this type of information, because everybody around you searches for information.
Facts.
So if you grew up around dumb people, if you grew up around people who don't read books or do study health or math or just anything, politics, government, laws, jurisdiction, legislation in their city, whatever, information itself, people who just go with the flow and just live and just follow what is given to them, which is nothing wrong with that to a certain extent, but you will be lacking the information as well, because you going in autopilot of what is done by everybody around you. If everybody around you eats majority of their food from the corner store and potato chips and hot pocket pizzas, and they don't have good hygiene, and they walk outside without shoes on, and 9 times out of 10,
you're gonna be in the same type of time.
You're gonna be in the same type of time. You might have slightly different variations about how you go about yourself, because certain things didn't. When you walked outside, your feet got burnt in the sun. It was a little too hot, and your feet didn't take it the way your sisters did, because she'd been running outside and climbing trees with her feet her whole life, and her shit hard callus underneath her feet. So she's more comfortable walking outside with her shoes, but neither one of y'all take baths properly though, because y'all both grew up dirty.
Yeah.
So you just so happen to wear slides and socks more. You see what I'm saying?
I see what you're saying.
You could compare that analogy to so many other walks of life and things in life, that people just do what they were told to do or what somebody else told them that was right. But then you don't start realizing until way, way later on in life that this particular thing or this particular way of thought, a trend of thought, was not right, or it may especially not be right for you. And you could have utilized knowing this information way earlier in your life to make impactful decisions, but you didn't make the correct decisions because you felt you was already within the right.
Ooh, that's a fact. No, that's a fact. You touched on something real quick. You touched on that, like being around people, being on the same type of time, and being a product, pretty much a product of your environment. Your environment.
Humans are creatures of habit.
Very true. Right. Whatever you do the most, that's what you're gonna be the best at. Goddamn it! If you ask a lot, if you lie every day, you're gonna get good at it. Right. You could be good at
it. You might not have a good lifestyle, but you're gonna tell good lies and manipulation that's gonna get you through certain situations that is going to give you the adrenaline and the dopamine in your brain to feel like lying helps me, and it feels good to know that I won from a something I made up in my head.
That's crazy. I tell my son every day, I say, whatever you do the most, boy, that's what you're going to be good at. You know what I'm saying? And you did rapping a lot, so you good at rapping for sure. But speaking of being a product of your environment, what environment did you come up in that made you this sauce walker that everybody sees?
Man, to be honest, bro, I grew up in some of the most worst fucked up predicaments that a person can grow up in, but in my mind and in my universe, I've always lived in my own world. I live in my own simulation. I live in my own program. I live in my own, like, I see this shit like a video game or something. I see this shit like an anime, like a cartoon.
Yeah.
I've always seen the world for what I see it is, not for what everybody else made me see it as. But one of the things that opened up that illustration in my mind was the trauma and the failures of life that was given to me. You know what I'm saying? The dice that I was given. You know what I'm saying? The cards that was dealt to me. But it wasn't always, it was always problem and trauma and turmoil in my life.
Did it
life,
feel like that as a kid? Or did you, or you just looking back?
Sure. Yeah, because, I mean, at the end of the day, what the fuck is the first thing that a kid want or a kid love? What's the first thing that a kid love? They mama.
For sure.
A kid love their mama before they love their daddy. You come out your mama, you the first food and nourishment that go in your mouth is your mama's titty. Facts. It's breast milk.
Facts.
I was that whole process was taken from me from a child to an adult. Mm. Like of my whole life, I probably was around. I always be talking about my mama, because I had way other situations. My mama wasn't my only fucked up family member. Like my whole family's fucked up, grandparents, all type of shit. The only person I had is a good person in my whole family tree, as far as like me being raised, is my father.
Mm.
He's the only straight person that's around my whole family, period. And my family is not big. I got a small family. I'm an only child biologically. I'm my only child, for number one. For number two, I don't have no cousins and relatives that are within my age group that was even around me, because we was all separated, like, from different... Because my dad family, his siblings, they all disliked each other growing up. Mm. So I don't have that... Oh, I went to my uncle's house for football practice, or I chilled at my auntie's house. I don't have those experiences. Ain't no aunties or aunties, none of that shit. It's me and my daddy when I'm with him. And then outside of me, my grandma dead, granddaddy dead. Then what's even more fucked up about it is that my whole dad's side of the family is Hispanic. They all Honduran. So they speak Spanish. They eat Spanish food. They do Spanish culture shit. And I'm not... I missed out on my whole Hispanic culture because of the feud. You see what I'm saying?
Shit suffer because of the great adults got going
exactly.
on.
Exactly. My grandma died, all that shit was over with. So then it was just me and my pops, you know what I'm saying, majority of my life, like going through all our struggles and shit, and him being a single parent father, trying to raise me, doing all this shit, he going through whatever, in and out of relationships with women, staying in different places, sleeping in his car, living in my daddy's car, like we did all that. But then with my mama, the few different years and different times I was with her, I'm in Chicago in the slums and I'm a stripper. My mama is a drug dealer, a stripper. She going to jail, penitentiary. Like, my mama had been to the penitentiary and left me in houses for 3 weeks with dope fiends and crack kids. And I didn't sleep in the back of her car 5 hours waiting on her to get off her shift at a strip club. Like, multiple times. Like, I've been through so much shit, but going through all of that stuff so young, so vividly in my face. And there's a lot of shit that I've been through that I don't even talk about on camera. Like, you know what I'm saying? But what I will say, like, the first time I seen somebody get shot in the face, I was 6-7 years old.
Damn.
You know what I'm saying? Like, I just...
6-7 years old. Shit.
In Chicago, see niggas shooting fake. Boom. Then come to Houston, see somebody else get shot. Boom. Like, I just seen so much shit quick, young. You know what I'm saying? Like, even when my mama died on FaceTime with me and my nephew my little cousin Gohan, packing to come move with me in Houston. Like, I always be going through some crazy-ass shit. Like, I'm on FaceTime with this nigga while he holding my mom in the arms, trying to revive her back. Like, I done been through so much crazy shit in life that I seen young to right now. I've always lived in an imaginary reality that's really my reality, because everything that I'm dealing with to another person is down there like a dream or a nightmare. Mm-hmm. It's down there like some shit that they can't even see as being, like, prime example. My daddy been paying child support for me the entire time that I ever lived with him. I've only lived with my mama for like maybe 6 years. My mama died when I was 26 years old. Of the 26 years of being alive, I probably only lived around her for 6 to 7 years of that.
Oh, wow.
From a baby of zero coming out of vagina to a 26-year-old man, or 20, whenever it was, about 26, 25, whatever, when she passed away, I was only around her for like 6 or 7 years. Mm. That entire other time of my life, I was living with my father. And my entire life, my daddy has been on child support with half of his check is getting taken from him to pay for my mama while she's in Chicago living her own life, doing whatever and getting high and just...
So he paying twice.
Feel me? So now... I'm losing from three different perspectives. I don't got my mama around. My daddy not having the don't have sufficient funds to take care of his own lifestyle, his own dreams and aspirations that he want to do for himself, and he got to work double the time because he's trying to make up the money that he already losing for paying for child support for the kid that's in the house with him.
Mm.
So them extra finances that you paying to the government somewhere else ain't even putting food in my mouth or putting shoes on my feet for me to go to school or not keeping you in a stable car to drive or keeping, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah.
So my daddy damn near living off of women on top of him having his jobs and being security, doing whatever he's doing, the hustling, like figuring out his life. You feel me? I'm seeing him be around beautiful women that's having like bigger jobs or bigger shit going on, and he kind of like finessing out there. Like, I just seen a lot. Young, you know what I'm saying? Then this nigga a wrestler, then he a athlete. Just,
you gotta have multiple hustles.
It's just so much shit going on that I'm just downloading everything that's going on. Then the hood and being from Houston and Houston culture and everything that comes from that. Then boom, being shipped out to Chicago for different years of my life. You know what I'm saying? Like I said, 7 to 8 years. Yeah, like 6, 7. I wouldn't give it no more than 8, you know what I'm saying? And then even if that spread of one of these years, I was around my mama for 6 months or 4 months, and then the rest of that year I wasn't. But then 2 more years, I was around her for 3 months or 4 months, and then it added up. But then right here, I was with her for a year straight or 2 years straight. You know what I'm saying? Shit like that. But it definitely ain't surpassing 8 years. And even of those 8 years that I was around my mom, it wasn't a 365-day nothing. Like, you motherfuckers that went through 365... Who the fuck haven't went through a 365-day period with their mama? Mm. The fuck? I haven't even had those. You know what I'm saying? Like, I don't even know what that feel like. Your mama telling you, hey, baby, put some deodorant on, and I'm going to go buy you some flowers for this girl for Valentine's Day. Yeah. I missed all of that shit. I didn't see none of that. You know what I'm saying? My kids being born, my parents never seen none of my kids, my grandma, none of my grannies. Like, it's just so much shit.
I feel like even within that, you still, like you said, I'm sorry to hear that, you know, about
your mom. I'm crying about this shit.
I'm just understanding
what I grew up.
And then like FaceTime with them up, but you was still, like you said, you was trying to bring her up with you.
Yeah.
Even with all that, you still was like, man, I still want to take care of you.
But that was only because I finally got to a place with myself where I was like, all right, I'm a millionaire now. I done did good. I got this shit going on in the streets that ain't got nothing to do with rap, that I've been doing good. Yeah, I really feel, I feel like I'm getting back out of life for what was taken of me.
Mm.
So let me go on. I want you to meet my child. I want you to meet my daughter. I done had a daughter now. I want you to meet her.
That's real.
You know what I'm saying? Maybe I can help you. Because my mama was still on drugs. My mama still had a drug addiction all the way till she passed. You know what I'm saying? So she would be on and out fighting and shit. But like, I was thinking like, maybe this is a way I can help you and help myself be a father and all this old shit. I was just trying to do something different, and it just didn't work out for me. But I ain't going to sit up here and lie. Like, I didn't have no resentment. And I was fucked up with my mama for years. I used to not like her at all for the way it went. You know what I'm saying? Like, why would you have me and make me to not fuck with me, and not because of you can't, or not because you don't know how to survive or make money, but because you really addicted to a substance more than you not even. I would felt it if she was addicted to what I'm addicted to. I'm addicted to success. Mm. You know what I'm saying? So working hard. So even when I came of a certain age, it would have started panning out and making sense why my mom is not around as much, or why she don't support this, or why I'm getting in trouble in school or going through these things, and everybody else got their mom that's going to argue with this parent, or like teacher parent meetings, conference, whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah, you telling me my child doing this and doing that, but I want to ask you a couple questions to make sure.
Come on, you ain't running game.
Yeah, y'all ain't running game when you treat my child like this. Like, I've seen so many mothers and people defend for their children. Nobody's going to defend for their child, especially the way a mother is.
That's a fact.
The fuck? Who gonna go hard for you the way your mama is? You, the only person that even have that in them to go half as harder to you as your mama is your grandma.
Yeah.
I never had neither one of those.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying? So it's a lot of the like the little crybaby shit and the security and the safe place and the, you know what I'm saying, somebody to call to you and all that other shit. I never had that shit.
I was just about to ask you.
I went through all the hard shit the hard way, like a man, from a boy to a man. I've always dealt with life as a man. I've always had to think and move and act like a man. That's why at the same time, I do all the childish shit and I do all the fun and having fun and not giving a fuck because my childhood was raw for me from the time I had a childhood. So at the end of the day, I'm going to make my whole life fun. I'm going to make every part because I know I'm smart. I know I'm prepared. I know I'm skilled. I know that I'm highly enlightened. I'm damn near too enlightened. I know some shit I ain't supposed to know anyway. So at the end of the day, like, why the fuck would I not enjoy this shit? You know what I'm saying? Why do I gotta act hard? Most people that act hard is weak as fuck. You know what I'm saying? How they try to say, the loudest person in the room is usually the brokest person in the room. Times have changed. You see what I'm saying?
Ooh-wee.
You feel me?
Yeah.
To say that is then to say, like, the person that has the largest marketing campaign in the room, it might not be the biggest company, it's other companies because they're putting so much effort and energy into putting their brand and their logo out there.
Talk about it.
It's the same difference. Tell that to fucking Nike and some of these other companies, it's a different noise. Just because it's not coming out of their mouth, they're still being loud and all in your face and making sure that y'all remember who and what and where this product or this entity or this thing that is being sold and marketed and distributed to other people is coming from. And I understood that young. I understand advertisement and marketing and branding and, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I just always understood that from young also with the shit that I went through. So it's like, I've always had to be in my own support system. I've always been a level of independent throughout my life. But even still, to say that I went through all of those things, I still did have certain times in my life where I lived in the suburbs or I seen, good shit about life, little family trips, but that was never my shit. You know what I'm saying? It was already some borrowed shit. You know, I'm going on somebody else's family trip or I'm with my partners and their family or my daddy that married, you know what I'm saying, somebody or he's dating a woman at the time that's doing exceptionally well for herself, so I'm going on her kids' family trips and shit with them, which is, you know, it's cool, but
yeah,
that ain't your blood.
That ain't your blood.
Yeah. That ain't your family. You the black sheep. You the extra kid. You the extra meal. You the extra
this. Well, that's
this.
Your son. You
that's
need
your,
to...
Come on. That's just reality. Even though my stepmom, who is my father's wife, has done nothing but love me and treat me exceptionally well, but it's just... Life is life, you know what I'm saying? It's been a bunch of things that went on with other people and other shit that got to do with it that I would never hold against her, but it don't change the reality of what went on with me. You know what I'm saying? See what I'm saying? So at the end of the day, it's like, my life's just different, bro. I went through a lot. But ain't everybody been through this. I ain't the only person been through shit.
For sure.
But everybody in the hood know what it feel like to not have their daddy. Most people don't know what it's like to not have their mom.
Yeah, because most of the times when you look at it, especially in a black situation, it's like, man, I ain't never met my daddy, man. Fuck my daddy, man. You know what I'm saying?
You, and
like,
guess what? You look what you just said. It's a clique of niggas to hang with that feel like that. 50 groups of them. You gonna hang with these group of boys that I say fuck they daddy. You gotta hang with these group of boys. Oh, my daddy in jail. I barely talk to him like that, but he kinda cool. He around.
Yeah.
You can hang with these other group of niggas, man. My uncle, my daddy, and my stepdaddy, my daddy, and fuck my daddy. And that nigga just came back when I'm 13. Now you know what it is. My daddy, I'm gonna fuck with him. It's 5, 6, 7 different groups of niggas that got fucked up relationships that you can hang with. Yeah. When you in a I don't fuck with my mama group, who is in that group?
Shit.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
People don't understand the level of demo. People don't understand the level of trauma it is, or the level of how serious it is until it's explained to you or delivered to you in a certain format. And then the world is already biased, and the world is already double standard set in so many ideals of life. So people already feel like a man's supposed to go through this and that, or a man's supposed to understand being lonely or being left out. Or
that's a fact. Robot, you don't supposed to have emotions.
You a man, which is all cool, but at the end of the day, most men got the grace and the privilege of, as a child, to be vulnerable or emotional or go through their softer moments where they got toughed up by their uncles and their parents, but they still had their mama to give them that hug when you had the boo-boo and cried, or when you got beat up and certain shit. They still had to have those moments where that one person is, oh, baby, I don't care what happened in the world, I love you and it's going to be okay. It's the difference when you never had that shit and you still went through all the worst shit in life. Fuck, my dad ain't finna goddamn, he a man, he not finna sit up and hug me and, yeah, baby, it's going to be all right. Fuck, my dad, a goddamn action athlete at that.
Let me it's crazy because, you know, sometimes, like, my daddy grew up without his mama. And he grew up, my granddaddy just, you know, granddaddy gonna beat that ass.
Yeah.
Granddaddy ain't going
hard,
for shit, ain't playing
love.
The shit.
Ain't going for shit, and yes sir, no
everybody
sir.
Everybody say feel like he missed out on that love. You know, like that love that you talking about.
Yeah.
And it's like, mentally, how do you cope with that? You know what I'm saying? Like,
me,
how do you
work?
Yeah.
Me, work, money. I mean, at the end of the day, it's still you fucked up in the head. I mean, my way of thinking is different. I do certain shit that other people wouldn't do. I feel certain ways other people don't feel. Certain shit I just don't feel at all.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, for me, I feel like the most important thing to do is succeed. Because in my personal opinion, in my personal life, I believe that the seed of all of my problems and hardships that I went through in life was financial illiteracy, lack of finances, and people with great talent. Both of my parents, great talented people, and they both different respected areas. That, because like a lot of the shit that's good about me, I also get from like my mom, like my vocabulary and the way I talk, poetry that come from my mama.
That's a blessing now.
For
she
sure.
She bless you with that.
For sure. Like, certain shit, I won't discredit her for certain shit like that. She definitely, you know what I'm saying, taught me how to talk and pronounce it and use my words and have conversation, poetry, write poems, shit like that. You know what I'm saying?
I was going to ask you where you got that slick talk from.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? I do. She from Chicago. You feel me? My daddy from Houston. I'm from two of the most slick-talking cities around as far as, like, having lingo and, you know, like, the older Chicago, the 80s and the 90s Chicago, it's a lot of history and sauce and flavor and black culture that come from there, and a way of words and talking that come from there. A bunch of player pimp shit come from Chicago. Same thing in Houston. You know what I'm saying? So I'm a mixture of those two pots. But back to the original question, like...
Coping with everything.
Yeah, coping with it. It was more just like, what better is there for me to do besides sitting up here thinking and making excuses and crying and complaining about what I'm going through versus to just working through what I'm going through and keeping the vendetta and the monkey and the chip on my shoulder to get a certain type of a revenge on everybody.
Is that what fueled you, though? Because, you know, so everybody got
why,
different reasons
yes.
for why they do hip-hop. Some people like, I want the
yes.
money. Some, okay.
Yes.
That was the reason why
you lie? Doing I'm not like these other people that's going to lie. Like, I always say this, I'm not the rapper nigga. They be like, yeah, bro, I never wanted to rap, bro. You know, I was just in the hood. We was trapping one day. And my dog said, you know what, bro? You should rap, dog. You'll go hard at this shit, bro. You do like a rapper. That's bullshit.
That wasn't you. Yeah.
And half of the niggas that say that, that's bullshit. It does happen in cases. You know what I'm saying? Sure. I even know people that like don't necessarily want to be a rapper, but they got the image and they got the style, but they play around with it. It happens. 90% and 80% of these people wanted to be rappers their whole life, bro. This is fucking rap. This is just, that's like saying a person that played football from Pop Warner didn't want to know you was gonna be a quarterback, bro. You've been throwing the ball since you was fucking 12 years old, bro. Yes, you did. What the fuck? I hate when people. Yes, you did. You wanted to be a rapper. You wanted to be an actor. You wanted to be a football player. Yes, you did. You know what I'm saying? You wanted to do that. Rapping just has a stigma to it, to what motherfuckers don't like to be called rappers and say, I want to be a rapper. I'm so much of a street nigga and so much into street shit and have so much of a track sheet and success in street shit, rappers and people in the rap game don't want to call me a rapper because I don't act and do shit that rappers do as of right now. This is a conversion of me becoming a rapper right here. Me actually stepping into the corporate side of the music industry and being somebody that's accessible and easy to work with within the music industry and like kind of following the rules in it. Like I've always been completely different from that shit because again, I've been doing it so long and understanding what I'm doing exactly, what I'm doing it as I'm doing it. Therefore, I knew the ins and outs from the business aspect and the musical aspect to where I was already to pick the things that I didn't want to deal with and be a part of with my music career because I knew I was going to be a successful rapper. You couldn't tell me I was going to be a successful rapper. So let me go ahead and learn what this music industry shit mean, and what does a record label mean, and what does a publishing deal mean, and then what does a mechanical royalties, and what is this, and what is that, and I had to learn all that shit.
I was about
shit.
To say, because that type shit, you got to be rap. Somebody got to teach you that shit. You got to learn that shit. Somebody got to do your homework or whatever it is. Otherwise, like you said, financial literacy, you get your head hit. You know what I mean? I mean, you done, everybody learned lessons. Everybody played the fool at some point in their life. You know what I'm saying? What would somebody like, I guess, the difference between you now? Because you've been, what, 20 years in the game doing your thing? How long would you say?
I mean, as a successful rapper or a celebrity rapper, 10 years.
Okay.
Rapping and perfecting the art of rapping and trying to rap, yeah, I've been rapping for like 20 years.
If you can go back.
1993. I'm 33 years old. It's 2023. I first started rapping and freestyling and putting songs together, 1993. I recorded my first song in the studio in 1996.
Damn!
The first time I did a mixtape, a freestyle tape, like a screw tape.
Yeah.
They called mixtapes, but
for
us, it's a screw tape.
True. Yeah.
The first time I made my own screw tape, went to the studio, put the headphones on. They play you 6 beats. You know what I'm saying? You're going to have... They just say, you got Jay-Z, it's a hard knock life for us.
Yeah.
It's a hard knock life. So you got that beat come on first. You freestyle over there for the first 10 minutes. Ooh. I'm not 5 minutes or something, whatever. Then the next beat come out, Missy Elliott. Hi, boy.
Yeah.
It's this sauce Walka. Know that sauce talker. Pull up in the Benz with the Rosa Parker. She can sit up in the front, not up in the back.
Yeah.
It's the freestyle king rolling up a sack like that. Got to keep the get. Know I'm gonna spill, I'm gonna splash, I'm gonna split. That's the perspiration. On the PlayStation. It's the sauce Walka, the coldest rapper in the nation.
Ooh.
I'm on hood clips. Pass me some chip.
Yeah.
Pass me some salsa too so I can dip. Maybach whip, that's what I'm rolling. Diamonds in my mouth and the chain is golden.
Yeah.
Brr, it's frozen.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. And it's, you just rock out to it.
Yeah, same
and it's
shit.
Just natural because that's natural. The culture of what you've been doing forever and what you've seen and what you was around.
Freestyle off the dome right here, right now.
I appreciate that hood clips. That's fire right there.
Hood clips. Ooh, that boy got that drop.
Hello.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying?
Yo, that's what's hood, man. For real, for real. Like, yo, what you doing right now is definitely setting a lot of tone. You're looking out for Peso. You're looking out for the whole TSF family. You know, what for people watching, like, man, what I want to be down with TSF, bro. How the fuck I get down? You know what I'm saying? How would somebody want to, you know, be a part of TSF if some people
ways.
That want to be a part.
It's a few different ways. It ain't easy. It's hard. All the ways to get in the sauce is hard. For number one, you know what I'm saying? The sauce has to be in you and not on you, for number one. So it's a certain way of living and a certain way of thinking and a certain way of handling yourself with other people. And especially friends, family, and women, you know what I'm saying? It's a certain level of respect and honor that I expect the person to have for themselves and for the friends, family, and women in their life, you know what I'm saying? In a positive way that I feel... You know what I'm saying? Me and all of my brothers share this ideal, a way of thinking that makes you match with us, for number one. And then second is the hunger, not the talent. Because I feel that talent is still a skill. Even though if you naturally are more talented than somebody else,
right.
A person can work and sacrifice free time to acquire maybe not the same level of talent as you, but to get very near the talent that you have, but have a higher level of skill, therefore they still are better than you. You just faster, you may jump higher, you may have a quicker reflex, but you don't have a higher level of IQ at this particular craft than this person. So if they're more craftier than you, they're more ingenuitive than you, and more... elusive and time responsive to whatever that situation is versus to where you are, they can still beat you through thought, even though you're physically more stronger than them. I can outthink you to beat you. So I don't care about a person necessarily having the talent. When I have so much talent and so much skill, I could teach anybody how to be a rapper. I could teach anybody how to be famous and charismatic and take over the camera. I could teach anybody how to do decent interviews and market and sell a product. The things that come within the realm of being a rapper, I can give you all of that. I can't make you not be lazy. Mm. I can't make you be responsible. I can't make you want to hustle and understand the difference between, to understand the stigma and the disposition or bad image and aura that you put on yourself if you don't keep a certain amount of money to yourself as a man, or if you don't have a certain type of a work regimen and you spend majority of your time playing the video game and trying to get your 2K player attributes. You trying to get more VC points on your 2K player than you in real life.
That ain't real. I had to tell my son that, like, son, you really got to go in the gym. You can't buy that VC and get more speed, more agility.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
In real life.
In real life.
So a person has to understand those points and principles of life too, but also be willing to invest in themselves, even if it's not necessarily investing into me or TSL for me to spark the interest in you. Show me that you're willing to spend the money on your own self before you ask me to spend some money on you to sign you. Or you can beat all of that in one whop and come to me and say, hey,
I'm already
everything that you're looking for. I'm already ready. And I have the money to show you how serious I am to be an artist. And I'm willing to invest into you and invest into TSF to be a partner with you as an artist because I'm still a boss. Mm-hmm. Then you can get to TSF like that too. It's a business. You know what I'm saying? You can not buy your way into TSF, but you can
bring something to the table.
Bring something to the table to where I look at what you have as an artist and look at your portfolio and look at your situation and see if it makes sense and if it's feasible to where we skip past all the bullshit and all the tests, even though it's still going to be another sequence of tests that you got to go through. But we can get past a little bit of more of the personal shit and some of the personal artist development because you already are developed as a person. You already developed as a human. You already coming as a prepared package, ready to sell. So now I just have to upstream you and put you in a different marketplace or put you in a different distribution, different demographic that you wasn't usually selling to because your audience is way smarter than my audience. So if you already ready to go, but I don't know you. I never seen you before. I just met you 30 minutes ago. I met you on Instagram. I seen you at a concert. That's not enough to sell me and make me want to stop my schedule and things, ideas that I have going on to invest all the time in you to make you a successful artist. You have to convince me that to make me want to buy into you. So you have to sell yourself to me first. Even if it's not about you paying or spending money or doing a consulting or some shit like that or artist management for me to spark interest in you, you still got to sell yourself to me. For me to say, I want to spend my money
right.
on investing in you and signing you to my record label.
Show me how I'm going
to
make my money back.
Show me how I'm going to make my money back. Show me what about you is appealing outside of you think that you make good music. You think your song is hot. Your friends think your song is hot. No. You might be ugly as shit, though, in real life.
Right, right.
And if you're not you got ugly, and then you got special type of ugly, marketing ugly. You're just distasteful, not appeasing ugly. You're not even the type of ugly where it's different, and it's I've never seen this type of a ugly before, but I've never seen this. I've never seen an Ice Fish J looking type of a guy. So when he does this funny thing that goes with the way he looks, it's still what's called marketable.
Mm.
So you may not be handsome to where this fitness model or this beautiful young lady want to just naturally have a date with you without money and being involved and you just being some superstar. But if we put your face on a t-shirt and a cup, it's going to sell because what the fuck is that? You see what I'm saying? That's still profitable.
Yeah.
It's not your opinion. You see what I'm saying? Yeah. A lot of people want you to invest into what they have off of their opinion and the opinion of a few other people instead of what's actually the facts. See, if you're not broke, that's a fact.
That's a fact.
You coming to the table, you got money, you got finances, you got support, you got life tokens to spend on certain ideas and things that you would like to do, merchandising, shows, whatever, interviews, traveling, okay? That's a fact. If you have a certain amount of followers on Instagram, that's a real following. That's a fact. That's an audience. So therefore, not only do you have a product, you have an audience that you bring to the sale that already wants to consume the product that you have. You just don't have an adequate product to get you to a certain level, or you only sold them toothpaste, but you haven't sold them toothpaste, toothbrush, and floss packaged together. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah.
But people buy your toothpaste all the time, but they only buying it from 7-Eleven. You ain't in Target and Walgreens and whoop-de-whoop, blah, 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 blah. You only in 7-Eleven, but you still coming to me as a published product that's already going somewhere. Okay, now you got some points that I can look at and say, hey, okay, I can see where we can improve this and we can change that, or we can add this and subtract
make some money
that
off this.
And we can make it work. Versus you just coming and saying, man, bro, I'm telling you, bro, you hear my song, bro, just listen to me freestyle right now, bro, you gonna know I'm the one. If it's one of those situations, I'ma know before you open your mouth. I can just look at a person and say, that's a star. Or you have star qualities.
What's that? Is it discernment? That's, you know, we can kind of just look and tell off, you know what I mean?
No, I guess it is. I just know I have the vision. I have the mind.
I think that's what
okay, this is what I have. I have the Midas touch for number one. I have the touch that can make something that ain't even supposed to be something. But because I know I can do that, me having a Midas touch, if I'm still trying to make an inanimate object something that talks, I know that it's going to be way harder, though, even though it's possible. And there's some way in the world that we can put some engine and voice block and AI and tech and make this paper that never talked before start talking. It's way harder than trying to make a parakeet or a parrot imitate a couple human phrases that it hear, because you already do that. You get what I'm saying?
I got you.
Parrots already say, hello, fuck you, no, bye.
Right.
So all I have to do is put a little time and time into talking around you and muscle memory and brain memory and, you know, make you say what you are, because your brain and your body is already set up as a parrot to repeat sounds that you hear from other people. This paper has never did this before, but it just looked good, and this paper think that it's going to be, or somebody else in the room think that we can make this paper do what a human do. We're going to make this paper do some shit that it's not used to doing because we got the technology and the know-how to do it. But guess what? Now I got to put all these different teams of people and all this shit, and I got to go get voice boxes and all this different. You got to put so much energy into making this thing work. But if it works, it's cool. We all make money. But this takes a lot less work and a lot less maintenance, and I can still do the other things in life that I want to do personally and still make a successful product.
And you know how to make a successful product.
Exactly.
That's for damn sure.
So it's like, I know I got the Midas touch, but should I use it on this just because it can work, but this might be 2-3 years of work. I could do this shit right here in 6 months.
Yeah, yeah. Is it a good investment? You know, and speaking of good investments and having the right touch with everything, your music, you got the right touch with that.
Thank you.
Your marketing, you got the right touch with that. I mean, you done been viral so many times. it's hard to get a career off of it. Even down to the OnlyFans that you've made a lot of money off that. A lot of people want to label you as a pimp, Sauce.
I mean, I don't think that, you know, I've been a lot of different things in my life. I've been through a lot of different phases in my life. As of now, I'm an entrepreneur.
Okay.
I'm a manager.
Okay.
I'm also a content creator myself. So, you know, it's kind of hard. You know, I definitely come from that. Just like a person that comes from hustling, a person that comes from robbing, and you go through certain experiences in life that better you for decisions that you would have made the decision in the future, but because you've already dibbled and dabbled, or you've been around people who've done certain things that you're doing way more extreme, or they did it with a lot more negligence or whatever they did, and they hurt themselves or their families or went to jail for a long, long amount of time. So it showed you, I don't need to do that, or I don't need to go that deep into it. I don't need to go that route. I feel like I'm a person that, I've been in the kitchen enough to get burnt and to be around people that got engulfed in flames.
You'd rather learn from other people than...
Yeah.
Seen him hit his head, I ain't finna go around that corner and get hit the head the same way.
You have a wise man, you have a smart man, you have a dumb man. You know, I want to be wise, but to be wise, you still have to have experiences. And in the streets, I think I've done almost everything in the streets you can do but snitch. You know what I'm saying? I've done a lot of different things to experience and evaluate. And first of all, a lot of the stuff was survival. I had to survive, but I've done enough in the streets to know what was absolutely right for me and what was absolutely wrong for me. And then what are certain things in life that it might be a skill set or something that an ideal that I agree with, but I can't partake in it and deal with it the way it's being done.
Yeah.
I can't be in this world and in this space from on this level because I'm bigger than that. So I've always known that I'm bigger than pimping. I'm bigger than standing outside with a girl or waiting outside a strip club for a girl. Like, to not say that I've been through those experiences in life, I can't. My mom was a dancer. My uncles was pimps. I was born around that stuff. Just like you said, my glass of water. Subconsciously.
You saw that.
Exactly. It wasn't that I wanted to see it. And
that's what you grew up seeing and knowing.
I grew up seeing and knowing it. And then I also understood that there was a Hugh Hefner out there. You know? And it's,
didn't look like he was living a bad life either.
Yeah. The guy that made the Girls Gone Wild DVDs.
Ooh, I remember that.
I seen other people. Well, the guy that owns Budweiser, they only use his beautiful cheerleaders from the Dallas Cowboys and San Francisco 49ers to advertise Budweiser. Yeah. I seen certain things in life, and my head was already fucked up to where, okay, how can I do this professionally and legally? And I start doing it myself. I'm OnlyFans. I'm a content creator myself. So it's like I'm grown to a point in life where I'm so much bigger and greater than those titles that people just try to throw on me. I'm an entrepreneur. I'm a genius. I'm a businessman. I'm a visionary. I'm a LLC owner. I'm an incorporation owner. I sell jet cars. I manufacture jet cars. I sell clothes. I manufacture clothes. I have a data mining team. I got websites. I got apps. I do a lot of different things in life. But yes, I have managed models. And I have also been a content creator myself.
And it's working out,
you know what I'm
for
saying?
You.
And it's worked out for myself.
Who got saying? Your net worth around about $7 million? You feel like it's factual?
You know, give or take. A little up, a little down, a little up, a little around, you know. I'm going to say this. I've made a lot more money than that in my life. You know what I'm saying? And I've kept more, but I've lost a lot too. You know, that's what come with it. I've always kept way more millions than I lost. And I've always kept way more millions than I spent. And I'm always, I always have reoccurring revenue. But at the end of the day, one of the best things that's a testament of my story and my glory was that I know what it feels like to go rock bottom or to gamble everything you have on your confidence. And I don't want to say falling short is good. Falling short. Never failing, but sometimes falling short to where, and sometimes falling short is not always on your own actions, on your own judgment. You know what I'm saying? You again, I'm a leader. I'm a caretaker. I'm a coach. So a lot of times, I might have the right game plan, I might have the right strategy, but my players may not be playing right this season. They may be going through personal mental injuries.
Yeah.
They might be going through physical injuries. They might be going through legal troubles. But that still affects the team. That still affects the record of the coach or me, the star player, whichever position you want to put me at.
Right.
So I've experienced those things in life where some of those things caused us to lose money or not make money or not have certain relationships that were fruitful financial relationships. But, and having to search and find a replacement for those finances or for that money.
You need that money to come in. And when there's a gap, it hit different.
It hit way different.
You'd be like, hold up, what's going on?
It hit way different.
We got to plug that hole.
Yeah, so, I mean, my original goal in life was to be a millionaire before I was 30. I was a millionaire by the time I was 24 years old. By 24, 25, I was playing with $2 million.
Like, what would you say your best investment was? Yeah, like, goddamn, I'm so glad I did this, because when I did this, this changed the direction of my money.
Jewelry. Jewelry. Best investment. Jewelry.
Really?
Yes.
People would say, you know, don't depreciate depending on what it is, you know?
That's dumb. Well, that's if you're using jewelry to sell it.
Okay.
Who cares? Why the the appreciation and the value of jewelry is in the eye of the beholder and then the artist in which that is wearing it. It's like a painting.
Yeah.
It took the same amount of time to paint this painting that was sold for $2 million as this painting that was sold for $50. It took the same amount of time.
Yeah.
It's the perception of the seller and the buyer that puts the value on the product. So the thing about jewelry is, of course, once you get into, of course, it's levels and realms.
For sure.
So once you get in the realm of real jewelry, where it's real for number one, then you go, then after you get past the real part, the creativity, the craftsmanship, the levels of it, and then you put it on again a sufficient superstar or a sufficient product, it's like you put a
because I forgot
you put a Hellcat engine in a, I don't even want to say a Chrysler 300. The Dodge Charger. They were Dodge Chargers before they were Hellcats.
Yeah.
So when they decided to put that whatever cylinder supercharged motor inside of a bullshit ass Dodge Charger, they created the hottest car in America.
Mm.
Because it makes noise and it sounds a certain way and it looks a certain way and it does certain things and speeds. That's the same thing the jury does for a person that has the it factors. In music, it's the biggest promotional tool you
especially
can
in
use
hip-hop, I feel
in
like.
Hip hop for sure. It's the same thing as a BBL. Like, it's the same thing as a BBL chain, to a like, woman. People, it's a lot of if you don't have the work. Look at how many fat dudes get nice women because of jewelry and nice clothes.
Oh, you gonna hurt some feelings. You gonna hurt some.
Look
feelings,
how many dudes that would never that most women would never give them the time of day if. He didn't look like a bag.
Mm.
Jewelry in hip hop falls up under that same special social media and all that shit too, because a lot of people are subconsciously again trained mentally and groomed mentally to not take an artist serious until they feel like he has a certain amount of money or he can spend a certain amount of money and he can wear it because it causes the attention. It attracts the eye. When we go to a club, I see these guys in the section over here with a bunch of jewelry on and it's glittering and it's shining and all this. It could be another section over here with guys that got more money than these guys and they popping bottles and stuff, but the attraction and the attention on the club is the guys that's dressed nice that got all the jewelry that's lighting up the club without sparkles.
Mm.
Because perception-wise, they look like the money. These guys over here own fucking the Ring app.
Right.
We in Club Tao. They own Ring. They got crazy money, but they don't look like it. Money. So if they not, again, up in here with T-shirts that say Ring or a sign that says, we made Ring, I don't fucking know to go talk to them about investing in with them or telling them my new business idea or I want you to come and sponsor this fucking whatever we got going on and we're going to advertise you and do cross-promotion. People don't know how to do that. Jewelry. You look nice. You look the part. Your jewelry shining. Hey, maybe I should try to do something with that person. See what do they do? What do they have going on? Who is this person? It's the same thing as a fat girl or a girl that don't look that good. Or even if you is look good, you can be the most beautiful woman in the world. You need your veneers done. You need to wear a certain type of hair.
Yeah.
You need BBL, your body to be a certain type of way. You need to work out and diet a certain type of way so your body be the certain type of way. It's something that's a finisher. To something that if you already have the package and you already have everything else that's needed necessary, it's bigger than the icing on the cake. It's the icebreaker.
Mm.
Fuck saying it's the icing on the cake. It's the icebreaker. The jury will make a person have a conversation with you, feel like they should have a conversation with you, or be receptive to what you're saying or receptive of what you're singing simply off the fact that your jury is it. That's black culture.
Mm. You ain't lying.
That's just what it is, bro.
That's just what it is.
That's just what it is.
Damn. That was a mouthful right there. That was some real ass shit. Do you feel like, have you ever sat back and said, like, if my life would have went different, I would have ended up different, or I'm grateful for how it was, even though it was, you know, those hard times, those fucked up times, because I'm here. It got me here. Because sometimes when life is good for you growing up, you don't have that same hunger. You don't fight the same for the stuff that you want in life. And then sometimes where it's like, yeah. I don't regret nothing because it made me who I am. Is that the type of mindset you want?
Yeah, I don't regret nothing that I've been through. I don't regret nothing because, again, it absolutely made me who I am, the way I am, the success, the drive, the hunger, the relentlessness, not accepting no for an answer, all of that shit, true. But I also feel like, too, when you one of the few, because like I said earlier, everybody in the world been through something, but everybody ain't been through everything. So it's only a certain few people in the world that know what it's like to be through everything and still keep your own level of sanity. It's a lot of people that feel like they've been through everything, but they like to use excuses of the world to make it okay for them to run away from the problems or not acknowledge or take accountability for their partaking in the problems that they have in life or what they've been through, because the world has given you words like anxiety or stress, PTSD, and all that other shit, yeah, versus to this is just the realities of the world. And some people, childhood is not meant to be as pleasing as other people's childhood because their adulthood is not meant to be as pleasing as yours is. Or you may have a hard for life growing up, but you're blessed with health, and other people are born with a great extravagant life, but their whole family has poor health. Mm. Y'all getting cancers and leukemias and
yeah,
all other type of crazy shit that just like, you know, doesn't necessarily happen in the everyday homes where we from or what most people that I grew up dealing with. So it's like a give or take. But I definitely know a lot of people and know people that have had great lives and great upbringings and backgrounds and shit, and they still became successful and they still hardworking. They just probably like a little more emotionally inclined or more like humane or something than somebody like me that probably less extreme and more rational and less with like less extraordinary or extremely extraneous answers for certain shit in life.
Gotcha.
Yeah. But that I don't blame, the only way to be successful is to go through hardship, or the only way to be motivated is to go through hardship. It's probably the biggest motivator and the biggest table turner for most people. It's just like with health. A lot of people that's obese and that enjoy food and have that mental disorder that leads to their health being at disorder, they don't realize or take the urgency into getting healthy and losing weight until they finna die.
Mm. Damn, that's true.
They will argue you to death and tell you, I'm happy being obese. I'm happy being out of weight. I don't mind
eating this fried chicken.
Yeah, I don't mind that I'm breathing hard. And that's your opinion. And you're just shaming and da 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 until they have a stroke and the inside of their organs start failing and things happening where you can't breathe now. And now you look at everybody that was trying to give you positive advice and you was looking at them crazy. Now you feel crazy as hell, and they ain't got to tell you to get in shape no more because you don't like the way the inside of your body is feeling and the near-death experience that you have. So now you have the shock value and the scared straight factor of, I have to do this. Not that I want to do it. I have to do it. A person that's grew up like that through their whole life is second nature. I like to say first nature, but the term everybody's comfortable with, it's second nature to know, I gotta get money. I gotta survive. I have to eat. I have to find shelter. I have to make up something to sell. I have to sell myself.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I have to do something because I know without a shadow of a doubt, if I don't bring the food in the table, if I don't find a way to get in a house with warm heat, air conditioner, with hot running water, my magical mother, who's never there for in my instance, is not gonna walk through here. I never had to believe that the tooth fairy or Santa Claus is real because I didn't have real parents at the time. Mm. So how the fuck am I gonna get tricked in believing the tooth fairy and Santa Claus is real when I don't have two full real parents. Not nothing. Mm-hmm. My father never did nothing wrong. My dad is a super dad.
Yeah.
But even the shit that my mama did when the times and years, or I may have been with my grandma for my grandma in Chicago for like before she died, because they all died early on me. My dad, mom died at six. My dad's dad died when I was like eight, and he from Honduras and still lived in Honduras. He was a boat conductor. He barely was in America in the first place. I probably only met that nigga like once. Mm. I probably only met him once. He was alive the whole time. I only met him once.
Wow.
You know what I'm saying? My dad's dad. And that story goes on. You know what I'm saying? My mom, dad, fucking evil guy, fucked up guy. You know what I'm saying? He molested people. Like, he just fucked up. I was, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. You grew up different.
I grew up different. But it made me a Super Saiyan. Yeah. That's why Goku is Goku. Goku didn't grow up like the rest of the humans. Goku grew up like Goku. That's what made him a Super Saiyan. He didn't come from Earth. He went through some whole other shit, and he spreaded it around to other people, and he made them super. So that's just kind of what my story was. And I'm like how people say, I'm an open book. Or like, I don't have no complex with it. Like, I don't give a fuck. I embrace it. But that's also why my music is like that too. And people be like, how Sauce Walka be, how he's so crazy and obnoxious, but that ghetto gospel shit be so deep and so vivid.
Testimony crazy, bro. Yeah, testimony crazy. People got to stand up and clap for you, bro.
Y'all got to make up this shit that y'all rapping about or writing in the book. Like, if I wrote movies, my movies would be way better than Tyler Perry's and the people's movies, because I seen some shit that don't even supposed to happen. It's like a lot of the shit that I seen, I can't talk about on camera or talk about in interviews, but I know it in my brain. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, to see where you at right now. And at one point, they was trying to, give you 41 years? Were you looking at?
Yeah, 41 years.
41 fucking years. They was trying to give you, you know, and you were locked up. But that's crazy to see where you at right now.
Boy, like a motherfucker. All on the news. That's why it's always funny with me, like, with my city in Houston. And like, I've been famous in Houston since I was fucking 15 years old. Like, I've been a household name in my city. Like, everybody know me from Bad Shit, Trouble, rapping. I've been sitting there on the table talking to Jay Prince and them since I was 15 years old. You know what I'm saying? From being a problem in the city, like, man, we got to sit down with y'all and, like, calm y'all down. Like, I've been
on that shit.
Yeah, I've been had the crew of, you know, I've always been a leader of many men as a little boy. And I always, and that's another thing different about me too, not just being a leader, I was also good at being a follower, a little brother. There's nothing wrong with following greatness. There's nothing wrong, like that's one of the biggest things that, like, our culture and our people got to, like, get off as a whole is the phrase dick riding or a dick rider. That's honor. It's a difference between honor and glory than being a copycat or a follower. Like, how the fuck you think you want to be Michael Jordan without seeing Michael Jordan? How you want to be Kobe without seeing Kobe? How you want to play basketball without seeing somebody shoot? You sound stupid.
Yeah.
If you never admired the beauty of a shot going into a goal, the beauty of a picture of a photographer, or the fame and glory of a rapper being on stage and women falling to your feet and motherfucking me, you getting paid for dancing around the stage, then you would have never wanted to do it. Back to the glass. If that information was never poured into your glass, then you would have never drunk it. How can you drink something that was never there?
What, you talking that real shit? No, that's a fact.
You know what I'm saying? So
that's
like,
a fact. Hey, what's up, boy? I appreciate you coming through Hood Clips. Having a real ass conversation.
What's hood?
Come on, man. That's what's really hood. You know what I'm saying? Like, this right here, we'll be remembered for years and years and years, my brother.
Thank you. Love.
It don't get no better than that, man. More blessings to you.
Oh, TSL Business, man. Sauce Walka, that boy then album is out right now. The tour gonna be over by the time y'all see this, so just go download all my albums to get all my music, man. And if you can't find me on the internet, put your hands together and pray to the Sauce God for a sauce blessing and an anointment, and the flavor shall find you.
Amen.
Sauce man. Amen.